Okay, so this is a continuation of our DML operation using PL SQL. So this was a thing, right? Like insert pivot, this was a mistake. And the parenthesis, these extra braces were the mistake. So let's see, and we'll try to insert, and then we can perform the remaining operations, like update as well as delete. Let's click on save. And the 99th record, let's see. Okay, this is available now in the database. Now, the next thing is, how do we perform update? Okay, so let us finish the update logic also, the PL SQL, and then we can just come back here. So it's almost same, just updating only, direct update. So just copy this one. Okay. Okay, so this is our script. Update set values is equal to one pivo header ID like this. One by one, we'll set it. Set values. You want to write this one, this one. I think we can remove commit from, okay, it is an exception block, let it be. And here I think we can remove it. And exception block, we'll try to have it. And similarly, the return status and all those things, we'll just try to have them.
You go ahead, ready also, then update.
Sorry?
Update, no need primary key, right? Pivot header ID, no need, we're not going to update the pivot header ID, no? First.
Oh, yeah. There is no meaning, right? If you update pivot header ID, how can you get that record?
No. Set, actually it is there, you mentioned the
first part. Okay, sorry. Yeah, you should not do it. I mean, yeah, you should not do it. Yes, correct. Okay. Here, let's compile. What's the issue? Okay.
Variable.
Yeah. Can just try to have the same things here. Okay, that got compiled. Yeah, that's it. So now what we do is, so for update, so it is almost same copy paste. See, there are a number of ways we can implement. We rather than you know rewriting everything, right? We can just simply have a flag in the PLSQL with a y or n, and based on that y or n, it is y means insert and n means you know update. That way also we can do it. Okay, it seems a lengthy one. We all, I mean, see in the programming always will have n number of logics, right? So yeah. I'll just simply copy paste the existing one. This here till this particular same method, and I will rename this one. I'll rename this as invoke
update.
Yeah, so I'll just name it as invoke update. And this here, wherever the flag value is, wherever the flag value is n, but the problem is by default the flag value was, by default the flag value was null, isn't it? So we want to get all the filter rows where the flag value is n, but you know like as the value is null, what we can do is initialize, we'll try to initialize all the records during load, we'll try to initialize all the records the value as n. Okay, so that we can solve that issue. And other one is we just need to change the method name, so the procedure. So this time the procedure name is update pivo. So I'll just copy that. So this is only change, and remaining parameters we have same, so there is no change required. We just have the same set of parameters, no change required. And now what is other change required? Yeah, we need to invoke this one. So whenever you click on save, call both the things like insert as well as update, invoke update. And now we'll try to have commit here itself, not in the database. And the main change what we require is during page load, right? During page init pivot details view, right? So we are executing this. This is not enough. What we need to do is we have to iterate the all records and set the value to n by default. Okay. So what we do is like here, we just need to use a concept called row set iterator. Okay. Row iterator is equal to vo.create row set iterator. Pivo data. Okay.
The pivo data is any name, right? There no nothing.
That's the user defined name. Yeah, it can be any name. That's a user defined name.
But when we insert the new row, at the time only the y only is there. That.
Yes. When you insert a new row, the value will be y. By default, the value is n. Okay. This is how we can solve this. And we always need to close the iterator. Okay. It's like closing a cursor. When you open a cursor, it is always definitely we have to close the cursor, right? Okay. The same thing, same concept here. So update is almost done. Let's try. We can make the pivot header ID as, you know, like read only, and we can by default we can generate a pivot header ID using a sequence. Okay. Now let's say I'll try with update. So now the problem is like here, if you observe it, for the vendor ID and the vendor site ID, they were null. So, but in our case, what did we do? Mm-hmm. So here, if you observe, right, we got null pointer exception, isn't it, last time?
Yeah.
So vendor ID, we are checking, vendor site ID also we are checking, then we should not get null pointer exception, isn't it? Okay, we should not get it. Vendor ID, we are checking it. Vendor site ID also we are checking it. But the pivot header ID as well as pivot header ID and segment are mandatory, okay? So they are mandatory. So I'll just say, okay, remaining I'll just ignore. I'll make it as draft. We can just see here this one, whether this got updated as well as this got updated as well as the third one was updated or not. I'll mention it as update like this so that we can differentiate. Okay, let's save it. It says data saved, but let us get validate from database. Okay, got it. So just simply work very simply. Okay, Now this is how we can perform update. But okay, let us see the flag values. So now all the flag values are n now, isn't it? All the flag values are n, because when you just perform update, it has to be reset to n, isn't it?
Yeah.
But we have not done here. If you observe, let me do that. So as of now, we have just performed update. So by default, anywhere during page load, the value was n. Okay, let us try insertion now. Let's try insert. I'll say now 120, pivot underscore 120. And now what is the value of flag value y? And I'll click on save and just see, it is still Y, right? Still Y. If you click on save, what happens? If you're trying to reinsert a new record of the same PO, isn't it?
Yeah.
So what we have to do is for this one, right? For this one, so for the insertion, especially for the insertion, what we do is, so first of all, always call the update. That is first thing. I'll tell the reason why. And then in the insertion, okay, here, once you come inside the loop, just mention row dot set new row flag, row dot, what happened? This is row, okay. Okay. Row dot set new row flag as n, okay. This we have to reset. Okay, so this way we can, you know, like solve the issue of reinserting the same record again. Clear?
It is, but only everything is going to set null in the n, this one, n.
We are resetting the flag value to n, right? Mm. For the new records, for the new records only.
Okay.
Because we are getting the data of only new records, so obviously it will set the flag value to n only for the new records, not for the existing records.
Okay. Only by a only insert.
Yes. And now one more thing. So here, if you observe, right now, when let us say without updating also, let us say if I don't perform any update, but if you just call save, what happens is still all the data is getting to PL SQL to perform update.
Yes.
You understand?
Yeah.
See, now let us, if I just simply call save, right, unnecessarily these number of records will be sent to the PL SQL for the purpose of update. Because we don't know which particular row was changed. We don't have any that particular functionality in the OAF to find out which row is dirty. At a VBO level, we can find out whether, you know, like this particular VBO is disturbed or not. But row level, we don't have that functionality. So still we have a possibility. It is not that we cannot achieve it. We have a possibility. There is something called, you know, like OAP SQL entity functionality. So the functionality is, see, as of now, what we have used in the OAF, so we have used a VBO, a read-only VBO, and then for each operation, we have called the PL SQL, isn't it?
Yes.
So this way, the problem with this one is for each update, you will be calling a PL SQL unnecessarily. This is not actually a good one. The solution for this one is, so we have something called, we have to use entity object, but it is not the entity object which we have been using so far. It's a little bit different. And here, if you observe the normal existing entity object IMPL, right? So here, if you observe the XX mini FND server, if you see the extends, it always extending OA entity IMPL, right? This is extending OA entity IMPL. So now what we want to do is we want to use PL SQL for the purpose of VML operation. I don't want to use the OA entity IMPL. So what we can do is we have to use another API called OA PL SQL entity IMPL. That we have to do it manually. By default, it will not work. We have to do manually, then only it will work. So we have to use OA PL SQL entity IMPL. In this one, you can use a PL SQL. So the advantage of this OA PL SQL logic is you don't, like, your data will not be like, you will not hit the PL SQL unnecessarily. It will hit only when there is a change. For insertion, it will call the API. For updation, it will call the appropriate API. We doesn't need to worry about this all flag concept. Okay, we'll discuss that in the next session. But as of now, this is a picture. So now let us perform the delete operation. Okay, so as of now, we have done the insert and update. So for deletion, you know, like, again, you can have a single selection or multi-selection, and you can click on delete. Okay, so I prefer multi-selection. Okay. I mean, there is no reason, but you know, you just understand the iteration logic to writing some more extra code. That's the only purpose. Okay. Now DML stuff, and here right click, new, multi selection, and you require a selection flag now, isn't it? You require a selection flag. So go to the Vivo, and now create a new attribute called select flag. Okay. Select flag. Okay. Now what we have to do, whenever user clicks on this particular delete, find out the list of records where the flag values, select flag value is Y, and then just delete it. So here, if you observe again, we'll be calling the same set of concept, nothing much different, the same row iterator logic, get filter rows logic, you have to do it. Okay. So here, if you observe public void delete pivot records. Okay. Why this issue? Okay. So we have to use the same set of concept, the way we have performed insertion, right? The only thing is we just need to have change the flag, and we have to call the delete API. That's the only difference. So I'll copy paste everything. Okay, instead of passing all the parameters, you just need to pass only one parameter.
Yeah, one parameter only.
Yeah. So it's like always, you know, like we need to, we may be rewriting the same set of code most of the times. Okay, it's not that every time we have to write some new logic like that. Logic will be different, but set of methods, APIs will be same. Okay, so select flag. Okay, and we just require only PO header ID. Okay, we don't require any other columns. Yeah, return status, return message, we can have it. Okay, select flag, and first of all, check the API. So I think I have not written any logic as of now. We have not written the logic yet. So let us write that.
Delete.
Okay.
Yeah.
So declare the temporary variables. So generally, like in most of the projects, you'll have a appropriate, you know, error messaging framework. So we need to utilize maybe. We have to generally utilize that. So as of now, we just in a doc manner we have written it, but in projects that's how it happens. So there should be an appropriate error messaging framework if you are maintaining some kind of error mechanism PL SQL. Okay. Okay, it's compiled. So you just require three parameters. Okay. Now the parameters are delete this header ID and the return status and message, and the sequence will be 1, 2, and 3. And the method name is delete pivo. Okay. Yeah, where it is giving error, let's try it. It's fine. Yeah, okay. So we don't require all these parameters. You can just remove them. And this is 1, 2, 3. Similarly, 2 and 3, that's it. So here, if you observe, right, once we know the insertion, remaining thing is just a copy paste logic, insertion, updation, and deletion, right? So the same set of code, and we don't need to reset anything here, not required. Only select flag is Y, okay? And this just deletes data from PLC, database, until unless you perform commit, it will not get deleted. Okay. If at all, if you want to make it as auto, auto commit, you can just have a commit method after this. I'm just giving an auto commit as of now. Okay, so this is how we can perform deletion.
Select flag is you are going to select the whole row wherever the cursor is there, that select flag is going to buy.
Whenever you click on checkbox,
checkbox.
Yes. Multi-select. Yeah. Multi-select means checkbox. By default, it will come like that.
Okay.
So now let's click on 120. So it states selected records are deleted, but it is not refreshed. So we have to re-execute so that it will get refreshed. And check in the database whether it is available or not. 120 should not be available, right? 120 was deleted. It is deleted now. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, so to refresh, what we have to do? So as it is still displaying the same data, right? You just need to. So after commit, in just vivo.execute, that's it.
Okay.
So that it will get refreshed. So this is how we can perform the deletion. Now, so one more important thing is, as of now, we have called the PLSQL directly, okay? So let us say if you have any PLSQL function, we can write in the SQL query and you can use it. That is one way. Or let us say if you want to call the PLSQL function directly, the way using callable statement, that also we can do it. And other option is, let us say if I want to use a SQL query, how do we use it, right? SQL query, last time we discussed, we have to use a prepared statement API, right? So let us try to use both of them now, one by one. Okay.
Functional SQL, you can call in SQL statement, so both you can use
that. Yeah, see, what I'm saying is, whenever we perform, like let us say when you're trying to
recall,
when you perform... Let me tell you. The reason of introducing all these things is when we work with a CVO extension, okay, mm-hmm. what happens is you will not have flexibility to use VIVO.
Mm-hmm.
We don't prefer to create a dynamic VIVO like that. Mm-hmm. So I want to get some business logic from the backend. There is no way for me to create a new VIVO and all those things. The best, easiest way is I'll create a PLSQL procedure or a function. Let us say I want to get some value for a particular record. And I want to update that value in the page. So how do I do it? I need to call some particular query or a function like that. So either I'll just write a callable statement, or I'll write a PLSQL function and call that function from the CVO. So that is the purpose of all these things. Okay. Of course, we have a different possibilities. So based on the page, what we generally discuss, based on that, we have to think. Okay. So let me just... So now here, if you observe, right, this example, so what are we doing? So we are calling a SQL query directly. You're calling a SQL query directly like this, mm-hmm. using an API called prepared statement. Okay. So this is not required in our case, let us, because we are, it is a custom page for our case. And we can simply create a VIVO and write a query there. That is okay. But I'm talking about some scenarios where there is no possibility for you to create a new VIVO. In those scenarios, this is a logic, it is preferred to be used. This is the way you have to use it. No other option, I mean to say.
Okay.
Okay. So now let's discuss this one. Okay. How do we call a SQL query? What I'll do is, we'll just try to introduce some business logic. Let us say, I'll just have a button, and on a button, I want to call my SQL query. Okay. So in the same DML page, what I'll do is, the table action, I'll just create a button called get row count. Okay.
Yeah.
To just understand how do we call a SQL query directly? Okay.
Java, within Java.
Yeah, that's a major thing, yes, in Java. And this logic we can use whenever you have a appropriate business logic, get row count. And whatever the logic which we have written in the AM IMPL, right? The same logic you can write in the CO also. Okay. As it is a custom page, we have a flexibility to modify the AM, but if it is a standard page, you can perform only CO extension. You cannot go beyond that. In those scenarios, what we do is, what are the logic, what are the PLSQL logic which is written here? We'll write everything in the CO. That's the only change. It just simply all copy paste will work. No issues at all. Okay. Only thing is, you need to import appropriate methods. That is same everywhere, right? You have to always, whenever you use any of the API, we need to use appropriate import methods. Okay, let us save, and you click on this get row button. So this time what I'll do is, I'll try to write a logic within the CO, okay, to understand what is the import issues you face it when you write some logic in the CO. Okay, that's only purpose. So as of now, I have not written any logic, let us say. So now I'll say public void get row count using SQL. And what parameters we require? See, generally, right, whenever you write any logic within the CO, we always need to pass the page context as well as the web bin. We may not require always, but most of the times we may require. Okay, so I'll just copy paste this one. And next thing is, so there is no parameters. We don't want to use any parameter as of now. So what I'll do is, I'll just copy paste this total logic which I have. So okay. Now here, if you have the first thing is a DB transaction, OA DB transaction. Okay. So use the first one, prepared statement. Instead of using a callable statement, we have to use a prepared statement. Okay. Prepared statement. And for the transaction, what it requires? It requires AM. So what we do, just make use of the AM, this one like this. We need to get the AM instance, right? So we need to use that. And similarly, result set. You have a SQL query. What does it return? Try to think from a database perspective. You have a cursor. You have a SQL query, you have executed a cursor. How do you iterate? You require some kind of looping mechanism, right? There are a number of ways. You have an open loop, you have a for loop like that. Similarly, you have a SQL query which is providing a result. We have to use a prepared statement that provides a result using a result set. That's only difference. We just need to use something called result set concept in the OA framework. Okay. So if at all, if you want to have any parameters, we can pass it. See, now let us see if I want to pass some parameter, right? We can pass it. What we can do is, let us say, okay, yeah, that's fine. We can just ignore the parameter as of now. Okay, I'll just comment this. Maybe for your reference, you can use it. Select count of one from pivo header. Okay, this is our query. And in the prepared statement, I'm passing the SQL query, and this result set, prepared statement dot execute query, it is providing the result of your SQL query to this result set. And we just need to iterate the result set. And what is this particular SQL query is returning? It is returning an integer, isn't it? It is returning a integer. So declare a number initially. Number variable. So you just declare this like based on the result set return value, you need to use let us say if your SQL query is having three parameters, you need to use result set dot get integer or get number or get string like that, and pass the parameter number. Is the first parameter, first column or second column like that? So in our case, it is a first one. So I'll just use get int. Okay, get int followed by the index. And we don't need to set anything, and just simply close it.
String is there, no? String is it in string? Yes, one that returns. Oh, that is a SQL statement, right? Okay.
Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. So, is there any extra thing here? Okay, this is an extra then, right? Yeah. this next one. So let me reiterate the same logic. Now see what we have done. First of all, get the AM instance, then get the DB transaction. Because here, if you observe the same thing when we use any of the callable statement in our AM. So here, if you observe callable statement, get DB transaction dot create callable statement. So if you want to interact with the JDBC, if you want to interact with the database APIs, you require that database transaction. So when your AM is invoked, nothing but when you invoke a page, by default, the relevant libraries are invoked and they should be available in the runtime. Because when you invoke a page, what happens? We, as a developer, we will not initialize the CVO, AM, or EVO. That everything is initialized by default because of the framework has those particular foundation functionality. It will perform all those things. Now, to invoke any of the database API, we require your particular current transaction, as well as you need to invoke the appropriate database APIs, like a create callable statement or create result set, I mean, create prepared statement. So now in the prepared statement scenario, what are we doing? First of all, you get your database transaction and then get the database connection. Okay. And then after that, using the connection, you prepare a statement and call this particular execute query. So that's all we are trying to do it.
Yeah.
So here also we are doing a similar concept, little bit. It is not totally same, but little bit, like get the database connection, create callable statement, and then set the values and close it. So here, what are we doing? So get your database transaction and the result set, we know what is the purpose. And then we are creating a database connection. Okay, we are getting the existing database connection. And then using that connection, we are preparing a statement, and that we are executing it, then we'll get the result. Okay, so now once what I'll do is I'll return this one. I'll return from this method. So I'll just say return EVO count. So I'll just return here. Okay, and don't write any. So whenever you have an exception, never write in the catch block. Never write in a catch block. Okay. But how do you handle it? What we do is, so because you already have an exception, you are raising another exception. So framework does not know what to do. Understand?
Yeah.
Okay, what we can do is, if this is not null, if exception message is not equal to null, then we can throw this one. So this is how we have to handle it. Okay, no errors as of now. And call this method when you click on the get row count. Call this method when you click on the row count. Get row count page context comma web bin. So here, if you observe, we have not used the page context web bin, right? We have not used anywhere the page context web bin. So yeah, sorry, here we used it. Can you see?
Yeah,
we used it. So that's the reason we generally pass the page context and web bin whenever you create any method inside the CVO. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's try. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Let us say I'll delete 2 records. Okay, get row count. It's 5.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, one more final thing I want to discuss in this one is like calling a PLSQL function. Okay, calling a PLSQL function.
Delete it is refreshing immediately, no? Delete, we did not write any code to refresh.
No, we have written, right? We have vo dot exit query. Initially, it was not there. So then, yeah, then we, because as we know the reason, I just wrote that.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, one more thing I want to do is, let us see, how do we call a PLSQL function?
Yeah.
We just want to see how do we call a PLSQL function. Okay. So now, as of now, we have used get row count. We got the count using the what do you call a SQL query. Let us say how do we get a row, same thing like a getting a row count, getting a row count from a SQL function. But this time, what we do is we'll try to create a function with parameter. Okay, to just understand how do we pass parameter also. So what I'll do is in the specification. So I'll just create
function.
Yeah, I'll create a function. Function get line count. Okay, get line count. Return number. Okay, get line count and return number. That's it. Okay. No, there's a mistake. Acha, okay. This is table, right? Triple XP. Okay.
Yeah.
Count from the PU lines where PU header is equal to P underscore PU return the parameter. That's it. So just compile and okay, we've got some issue.
Body. I think specification we need to mention. Specification that is not there.
1 minute. No, it is there. See, function get, right? Function get return number. It's compiled. It says line number 146. There is an issue. Begin select count off into this star where pivot header ID is equal to.
I think into we need to get into variable we need to get.
Oh, how come this got missed? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, it got compiled. Now, so let's invoke this one. So it is a PLSQL component. So we have to use a callable statement. We have to use a callable statement. So this time, now in this scenario, what we do is we'll try to call the callable statement from the CVO to understand how different it will be. Okay. So I'll just say same thing here, same logic, get row count using PLSQL, get row count using PLSQL.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see how do we invoke this one. So I'll have my logic here.
Callable statement.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll say PO line count. Okay. Now, see the difference here is it is just anonymous block invocation only. It is still anonymous block invocation only. But here we have to mention colon one first. We have to mention colon one first. And after that, you need to mention the assignment operator and then mention the package name. So that's a different of invoking a function. So this is our package name now. So this is our package name.
Yeah.
And this is my line count function.
Mm-hmm.
And now how many parameters it is having? As per the PLSQL, it is having only one parameter, isn't it? But yes, now as it is a function, you need to start a sequence like this one, because it is returning a value that I have to catch in my Java and then mention the parameter. So the parameter name is PO header ID. Okay. Mention that. And now here you start with the next number. It is 2 now. Okay. Now just press Alt Enter so that it will import the remaining set of parameters API for us. Yeah, that's it. Okay, so get the AM initialization variable. So what we need to do, you need to use AM dot get OADB transaction dot create callable statement. Okay, if it is already, see, it does not need to mention AM dot if it is, if this logic is inside your AM. Okay. And now what is the parameter I need to pass? I need to pass, which parameter I want to pass? I need to pass a PO header ID, right? I need to pass a PO header ID. So now you have a PO, you want to get the line count of a selected PO, isn't it? So now in that scenario, what you can do is, instead of having a button at table level, you need to have a button at the column level, isn't it? We'll do that. We'll do that. So what I'll do is, I'll just pass, assume that I'll pass a PO header ID. PO header ID integer. Okay. Set integer parse int, integer dot parse int. Okay, you don't require integer dot parse int if you're already passing the PO header ID like this. Okay. Now callable statement, register out parameter. It is integer. Out parameter which you are getting from the PLSQL function is integer. So you need to set appropriate register. We need to register out parameter based on what it is returning from the PLSQL function. If it is a different one, let us say if you are passing a date or a string, you need to use appropriate like this. Date or a string or a var, I mean, whatever it is, var char like this.
Okay.
Okay. Register out parameter and then return the PO line count. So now the next thing is, how do you get the line count? How do you get the selected PO header ID? How do you get the selected PO header ID? So we know that, right? Like we just need to have a fire action. So on this one, let us say on this one, so I'll create new item, change the item style to submit button. Okay.
Yeah.
Get line count. Yeah. It does not matter now. This does not matter. Whatever the name which is there, it does not matter because we'll not be calling the logic using this button. We have to use a fire action for this one because you need to get the current selected row, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'll just say get count PLSQL file. Okay, client action, fire action. Okay. Now get the vivo name. Get the vivo name.
So we need to write the parameter dollar.
Yeah, OA vivo instance dot vivo header ID. Okay. Copy this. On the button.
Fire parameter.
Yeah. So let's say view align event. Okay, I'll say line PO header ID and the value is this one. Okay, now make a note of the parameter name as well as event name. We require parameter name as well as we require the event name. Now, so first of all, before finishing this logic, just try to handle the event logic. And then once you get the appropriate value, then we can think of the remaining logic, isn't it?
Yeah.
So now what I'll do is, event parameter, get the event parameter, okay. Now, so far these are all if and else condition for the purpose of the buttons. Now this condition is for the purpose of else if event name not equal to null, and if this event equals to, and here if you observe everywhere it is else if only. The reason is at any time you'll have only one event. That is the reason you need to always have else if instead of if condition.
Okay.
At any time it will have only one event. It can be either your button event or link event, nothing more than that. This is not this one. Okay. First of all, we'll try to see whether it is getting the selected PO or not. Selected PO is line PO header ID. So this way we can know whether the selected PO is getting raised or not. Okay, now
yes.
So let's see where is our get this one, right? This is a button. Now I'll just click on this one. Can you see the PO selected PO is 12?
Well, first one,
right? And similarly, you can have this one instead of button, right? You can also have image. Okay, I just have button here, but we can have an image so that looking wise it is good. So now what is happening? The button, it is like look wise, it is not good, right? Okay, but yeah, we can just go ahead with this. Now the next thing is we are getting the PO, that's fine. Some functionality is good. Next thing is just pass this parameter. So here we got the PO number, right? PO header ID, we got it. And the function which we created, right? What is the function which created? We created a function which requires a PO header ID, which is in a number format, integer format. Okay. So here, if you see, there is an API called integer.parseInt. Okay. Integer.parseInt. Can you see?
Yes.
You can pass a string. You can pass a string. Now let us, I'll pass a string like this. And what is the return value of this parseInt? Just control click on this one. The return value of this one is integer.
Yes.
So we're converting a string to integer and using this API. Okay. So we can just use like this. Int PO header ID int is equal to like this. Okay. And now we can pass this one to this API. Which one? Get
row count using PL.
Yeah. PO line count is equal to get row count using PL SQL. Using PL SQL, where is that? Yeah, this one. Page context, web bean, and PO header ID int. You can mention like this instead of PL SQL, you can mention PL SQL function. So that we can have clarity. Okay. And now you can just selected PO is this one, and you can mention line count is this one. So this logic is much, much useful. This is not a simple, this seems a very simple logic, but this is one of the most used logic in the extension concept. These are all things whichever we have discussed. So execute. Okay, so let's say which one we are using. Just check out which particular line is having data. Let us say 13 is having data, but do we have 13 header? No. 12 we have it. So I'll select the 12th one. Can you see the line count is one? Maybe I'll select the one which does not have data. Can you see? It is zero. Okay, we can select something which is having more data. I think, yeah, the problem is we. Okay, now 10. Yeah, 10 is there. 10 we can select. 10 to third row. Got it? That's three. Okay, so this way, you know, like all the functionality of PL SQL are covered. Processor, function, as well as calling a SQL query. So this is how, you know, like we can interact OAF with the database. The other thing what we discuss in the next session is like we'll try to invoke like this in this one, the what do you call the drawback of this particular functionality is like you're calling the database unnecessarily. That we can solve the issue using the OA entity IMP logic. Okay. So yeah, so this is all about the DML operations using the SQL and SQL.